Now moving on, you know, we have had two fantastic presentations. I would request Ms. Kanika Tekriwal to take over the stage. Her life journey itself is inspirational, so let her talk about what she has done and who she is. Why you're so proud to have her.
Hi, I'm Kanika Tekriwal. I'm from I run a small private aviation business called JetSetGo. Thank you for the lovely introduction. I don't know how inspirational or amazing what we've done is, but I think my journey so far has been lots of fun, and we've had a really great time building what we're doing. I think what I would like to share today is the three lessons I've learned in these short 30 years that I've lived trying to build a business. I think when I first started JetSetGo, everyone came around and told us that, you know, Kanika, who's going to book a plane on a phone? Why would, there's no market for private jets in India. Why do you want to waste so much of your energy into doing this? There were customers who said, aap plane bechoge, you know, aap boutique khol lo, cupcakes bake kar lo. Why would you want to get into something like this? When I went to the ministry and the regulator for approvals, the common response I would get is, you know, ye aapke bas ki nahi hai. Are you someone's secretary? But, you know, all sorts of funny things. I think that only made my resolve stronger, not to prove them wrong, but probably to prove myself right to myself, that I can do it. And whilst every day when I woke up in the morning, there were 1,000 reasons to actually stop doing what I wanted to do, there was that one reason which said, no, you have to go ahead and do it. My biggest learning from this was that, you know, if you continue to believe in yourself, there's absolutely nothing in the world that can stop you from achieving what you really want to achieve. I read this a lot in a lot of management books. I love reading, love watching a lot of movies. I thought about it a lot in movies, but I actually saw it come to life, you know, in the 3 years that it took to set up JetSetGo. I started the company with an investment of about 5,600 rupees. I ran away from home because I belong to a very traditional Marwari family where getting married at 18 is the right thing to do. So unfortunately, I ran away without a wallet. So note to self, if you run away from home, make sure you have a wallet with you. So that's all the money I had to set up this company, but it worked. So, you know, for about a year, I was, I think, answering phones with different names because I didn't want people thinking it's a one-man company, or one-woman company, rather. So I answered the phone with all sorts of names, different accents, different languages, just trying to, you know, fake it till you make it, I guess. But it worked. I think the other lesson that, you know, I learned rather the hard way again was, you know, a lot of times, you don't know if something's going to work out, you know. I remember when I employed the first employee that I did, I was like, will I be able to pay his salary? You know, it was such a stressful moment that I'm keeping this guy, he has a family to support, he has a set of parents, he has kids, etc., etc. But will I be able to pay his salary at the end of the month? You know, I mean, today we have a team of about 400 people whose salaries do go out on time. But at that time, I think this was 5 or 6 years ago, my biggest worry used to be that, will this work out? Will this happen? Will this, you know, should I do this? I think what I really learned from this was, till you don't take the next step, you'll never really figure out whether it's going to work or not. You know, a lot of times we prevent ourselves from doing things because we're just so afraid of whether it will work, right? But I think the universe conspires with you to make things happen. So till you don't actually go out there, put yourself in the melting pot, you won't really know whether it's going to work out for you or not. My third lesson, you know, which I've learned throughout my life since I was really young, would be, if I go back a little into history, I was, you know, one of those kids in school who was always a loser. I never had friends, I used to always stand in the corner. I used to love reading wasn't cool. I was that geek in class who never did well in class because I used to be reading storybooks instead of science books. I failed maths, all sorts of stuff. And, you know, being that loser in boarding school is not a fun thing because you're living there. But, you know, life went on. Of course, in college, it became really popular. Things worked out. But as I was planning on taking the next step, I was diagnosed with cancer. And again, my whole world came crashing down. I became that little, you know, lots of people said, well, you won't be able to live. You have 4 days, 40 days, 4 years, etc., etc. And this kept going on and on and on for like 1 year of chemotherapy, radiation, etc. When I did fight cancer and I wanted to set up this company, my parents didn't want me to set up this company. They were like, are you crazy? Sit at home. You've just recovered from cancer. Spend a year further recovering, etc. I said, look, I'll really shrink if I sit at home for another year after already having spent a year trying to recover. All throughout this, that one thing that you know kept, I think, working for me was that it's we hear a lot of no's in lives in our lives. We hear a lot of you know. We hear a lot of negativity. We are sometimes surrounded by negativity, and which wants to make us give up. But I think it's also up to us to turn every no into a yes. You know, as a kid in boarding school, my easiest option was to go back home and tell my parents that I'm not getting along in school. I want to leave. But I told myself I'm going to survive those 10 years in boarding school, because going back to Bhopal and working in a day school would have been more challenging. When I was diagnosed with cancer, I think the easy way out was, you know, screw it. If you have to die, you've got to die. Why go through all this pain of chemo, radiation, etc., etc.? But I keep telling myself that for every doctor who said no, you know, I'm going to turn around 40 years later, sit with them and have a drink and tell them, you said no, I'm not going to live, right? Same thing when I came to start my business. I think it was about, you know, trying to tell my rather than anyone else, that for everyone who's actually said this won't work, you know, I've got to prove to myself that it will work. So I think it's up to us to turn every no into a yes and use every no as a stepping stone to success. And this is one thing that I've really, really learned the hard way.
Thank you, Ms. Shetiwal. Please take your seat. And I request Shrina Kharpe and the star speaker of the first session, Shri Rahul Navika, to take this lead.
Shoe school, I
said. Okay, on that comment of shoes, let's move on. Let's press the pedal on this last session. You know, last sessions are always never easy. I was there in the post-lunch session, which is also difficult, and now I'm in the last session. So my job is to actually ensure that all of you stay here till the very end, and we have some good time. We learn a few things, and you heard a very interesting story of Kanika. I'll also ask Rahul to say a bit about himself, and then maybe we'll have some questions, you know, and responses, hopefully, on the team. But before I hand it over to Rahul, I wanted to add a two-minute kind of some story about the topic itself. And so one of the interesting things about working in APTEC for so many years was that I got a chance to go to a lot of emerging countries. And one of the places I went was in Vietnam. And we had a center which was teaching multimedia animation in a place which was around 80 miles outside of Ho Chi Minh City. So it was almost like a Class D, Class C city. So it was a very small place with very little population. And I saw a young kid there doing some animation work, learning. And on his t-shirt was a black t-shirt. All creative guys, you know how they are. And just the word Jesus is it. J-U-S-U-S, Jesus. That's it. So I thought, let me understand what he's doing. And I started talking to him, and you know, some of these creative guys, if you've dealt with them, they have no mood to talk to human beings. They like to talk to machines. And I was an intervention in his creative thought process. You know? So he was wanting to do something more creative, and I was asking him all his neatest questions. And the worst is the guys in the center saying, no, he's a CEO, he's a CEO. So that nags them worse. Creative guys hate CEOs coming and telling them what you're doing. After a great deal of effort, I kind of warmed up, you know, I kind of kept persisting. I wanted to know what this guy is doing. So I finally said, nice t-shirt, you know, just written the word Jesus. So he turns around, finally after, you know, 5-10 minutes of lot of effort and lot of persistence. So some of you may know me, I'm fairly persistent most of the time. And then he said, Mr. Kape, with a straight face, no emotions, straight blank face. This, remember, is a kid in probably a city with population of 13,000 or less, 12,000, in a remote part in Vietnam in a true sense. So he turns around and tells me, Mr. Kharpe, remember, I will be the world's best animator. World's best, not just best in Vietnam or in 2 years' time. So I also kind of, you know, just to amuse him, I said, really? So he got really upset. He said, Mr. Kharpe, do you know what I require to be the world's best animator? I said, what? I require a pipe, you know, for people in IT world, pipe is an internet good connection. and my mind without any borders. And I will be the world's very best. And you know, I could see it in the eyes. Then I backed up. I said, I can't have any. This guy is serious. He means business. And he said it with a straight face. So this is the aspirations people have beyond, you know, resources. What is the resource he has? He's saying, my only resource I have is my mind should not have a clutter, should not have a boundary, and I require connectivity. Now, these are the kids we are dealing with. These are the people who will dream to be the world's very best. And why not? They do have the capability of being the very best. I just thought I'd narrate this story to you people, because today's afternoon is kind of session, a lot of stories. Rahul also loves to tell stories, I know. So maybe with that, I'll go on to Rahul and you could add a few words on the, you know, topics we're discussing.
In today's age, when most kids talk of their dreams, most senior people also think of a pipe. But they think of a different pipe. What's a pipe? But I'll tell you what, when I was listening to Kanak and I had the privilege of knowing her for some time, I think today's era is more about possibilities. You know, and it's about wanting more. So if you look at her, she's someone who, and she loves to underplay, but this is someone who runs the largest private jet company in India. Okay. And just take a step back from a traditional Marwadi household, you know, fighting cancer at that very young age. And at that young age, a doctor comes and tells you, "Bhaiya, kitna hi din hai jeene ke liye." And she turns around and says, "FO, I'm going to prove you wrong." Fighting that battle would have been enough for anybody. That is a story by itself. And I know for a fact that she went all over the world to find the best technology, the best person, and just refusing to believe people who said no. And this is a specialist telling an amateur, right? But she refused to take that for an answer. Once she is cured, she would have said, "Full stop. Oh yeah, end of the story. No. Once more." Now imagine the audacity of a young kid coming from a traditional background, saying, "I'm going to build the largest private jet company. And probably I think she's going to build the largest one in the world soon." Okay. That audacity and the belief that it is possible to do it is what I would love to see in Goa happening, actually, honestly.
Great. So maybe I'll ask one or two things before, you know, kind of...
You need to ask her, but she will never reveal stuff about herself.
So if you were to start the same thing today, would you have done anything different?
You know, honestly speaking, this was something someone asked me yesterday.
Oh, really? Not me.
I thought for a really long time, you know, so, and this was on live TV. And I kept thinking, I said, you know, if I had to go back and change that one thing, what would it be? And if I look back, there's absolutely nothing I would like to change. Every challenge, every problem, every mistake, in fact, I think has only made us stronger and smarter. If we hadn't made those mistakes, I don't think we would have come as far as we are.
So Rahul, I wanted to ask you, today we're talking about aspiration beyond resources. I think some of us have kind of grown up in a situation where resources were limited. You know, you chased money, you know, capital, you know. Now capital chases you, in a sense.
I wish.
When I say you, I mean guy with ideas, you know. So, capital chases ideas, you know, a lot of the stuff is free, internet, knowledge. So in the true sense, resources are what is thrown at you, what you take. So in that sense, has there been a paradigm shift?
So I tell you, honestly, there is more capital chasing great ideas, and more than great ideas, great entrepreneurs. But as an investor, it is very tough to find the idea you want to, or the person you want to back with money. In fact, it's now the other way around. So earlier, when we used to have all these tycoons in Delhi, it would be entrepreneurs pitching to investors. And I think 3 years back, a tycoon was happening. And the first thing early in the morning at 9 o'clock, you had a bunch of 55 investors in a queue on stage, reverse pitch, saying, "We have money, please come." And when you looked at the other side of the table, there were like 15, 20 entrepreneurs who were all on their phones saying, "CKR." It has truly changed. Understand, we get money from our LPs. We are more stressed than the entrepreneurs. Okay. Having said that, yes, there has been definitely been a paradigm shift, whereas we are finding younger and younger people who are much more confident, and the kind of confidence Kanika had at her age, I wish I had when I was growing up. Because in our case, our limitation of ambition. Today, that limitation more or less has gone away.
Like the young kid in Vietnam.
Absolutely.
So how important technology in, so I'm going to come now next to all of you, so keep your questions ready. So how important is technology, you know, when you say about resources, going beyond resources, how important role, so in your business, how important was technology which is you're using?
Yeah, I think without technology, Jetset Go wouldn't have existed. I mean, just to give a simple example, you know, we've reduced the downtime of every private jet that we manage. We have a fleet of about 62 planes right now. And we've reduced the downtime is basically grounding for maintenance, repair, etc. We've reduced it by 71% in the past 1 year. And my entire engineering and maintenance team said, man, it's not possible. You know, we're giving us a target of 60%. Kaise hoega, this, that. I said, boss, 16 hoega, 60 se zyada hoega. And I'll show you how to do it. I got a bunch of my tech team people to work with engineering and actually build hardware and software to monitor health of these planes. And all most of our planes are quite old, 8 years, 10 years. The newer advanced planes have SIM cards built in them which give you signals as to their health of the engine, health of the APU, etc. But the older planes don't have any mechanism. So we actually built a combination of hardware and software